So welcome. We are here at JFocus. I'm Ixchel, Ruiz. I'm a developer advocate for JFrog. And today I have Thomas. So Thomas, please introduce yourself.
Hello. So my name is Thomas Endres. I am one of the managing partners at a consultancy called TNG Technology Consulting. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I came into this position by also founding the innovation hacking team. So this is a team where we play around with innovative technologies. We started with gesture control, went on to VR, AR, then recently moved on, or recently 4 years ago, we moved on to AI. And mm-hmm. with that, we are now also touring and showing our work, and that's why we're here.
Okay, sounds interesting. So tell me about your session. What did you talk about here at JFocus?
Yeah, we talked about real-time deepfakes. This is a thing that we did ourselves. So first, when deepfakes first came out, we were both terrified and fascinated by them because they were such a powerful tool for both propaganda, for misuse as well. And we wanted to know what was behind all the hype. And that's why we tried to rebuild them and then make them more versatile so that you could also use them in a real-time setting. So just put yourself in front of a TV screen and another person will look back at you with the same facial expression.
Oh my God. And I've just heard that you were very successful in that.
Yeah, we can now anybody can just stand in front of the camera and they will get deepfaked into the person that we once trained, and this will work for basically everybody who's in front of the camera. This is quite interesting and opens up new fields of application. So, for example, for TV, we could have people not the actor themselves, but different people acting as a different person. And at the same time, it opens up new possibilities for example, fraud. So it's also a very dangerous technology. And that's why we are also out here and speaking about it, so that people know that there is something like this out there, that it is possible to do something like real-time deepfakes.
And how difficult it is after you built the entire thing by yourself. So what is your insight into that? It's complicated, it's easy?
It is quite complicated. So it's one of the most complex projects that we had in our innovation hacking team so far. So we've put like 2 person years into this up until now. And we've played around with different techniques. So at the beginning, our real-time deepfakes looked like a video game character from 2005 or something like that.
That's not very credible, but what happened later?
Yeah, and then we moved on and we iterated over that. So we tried out new neural network architectures. We had new hardware. We also came up with new technologies that were not out when we first started with mm-hmm. with the deepfakes. And this is how what first seemed like an impossible task is now possible with normal gaming hardware.
Normal gaming hardware. Okay, that doesn't seem so difficult to find out there.
No, it's not that difficult to find, but all the brain power that went into this, all the effort that went into this. So this makes it difficult to recreate this. We are also not publishing them for obvious reasons, but just showcasing our work and showcasing what is possible. We also have them in one museum installation. So
what museum?
It's the Deutsches Museum in Bonn.
There. Oh,
you can have a look at it yourself and also try it out yourself. Sit in front of the camera and be one of the coaches, which are normally also there.
Nice. I didn't know that. I actually didn't know that. That sounds really, really interesting to try the technology by ourselves. And what were the main challenges for you, like developing the technology?
Yeah, I would say the main challenge at the beginning was getting it to run in real time.
Okay.
So that was the most obvious problem that we had, because at the beginning this was an offline process which could only be done using several hours on a normal graphics card, and then we optimized on that, made the network smaller, compressed it a bit, made the code a little bit cleaner, and throw out everything that was not absolutely necessary, and just replacing parts of the application that went that did not go that well, or that did not work that well in real time.
And are you happy with the state of the technology and the model and the execution of the model or of the program right now, or there are still, like, you see a vast room for improvement?
Yeah, there's still room for improvement. So, for example, our newest version of the real-time deepfakes is photorealistic, I would say. Mm-hmm. So you can really see the pores in the skin or something like that. So this is working quite well. But at the same time, this level of detail also introduced some chittering. So the faces are now a little bit wobbling around, and you can really see that this is not the real face, but just by looking at it and seeing that the normal head would not normally just wobble around, and there's not that much jittering going on in a normal face.
Okay.
Yeah, but these are problems that can be overcome if you put a bit of work into it, and with that we could also come up with perfectly realistic deepfakes. And also, there's another challenge which we are currently facing, and this is background eradication. So, what we are normally doing is we are replacing the head, but if we have, for example, if the person who is standing in front of the camera has a huge head, whereas the person we are deepfaking has a relatively small head, then we are facing some problems. And there are different techniques that we could use. We could, for example, just fill it in with surrounding pixels, but this will not be very realistic. If, for example, you have some text in the back, then it will not really be
that you can see like the boundaries, and that they stop making sense.
Yeah,
in a
exactly.
Way.
Or you could also have something like a warping effect, where the surrounding gets warped into the face, but this will also not be that realistic. So we could improve on that by, again, using neural networks to fill it with something which looks sensible. Then again, this will be a bit of work.
Okay, I think this is going to be a very difficult question. I hope it's not. But and how about detecting that they are deepfakes? How are we ready for that? Not at this point. That's, I think, even common sense like will help us a little bit. But what do you think? Are we working on that too? Not yes?
So the problem with detecting deepfakes, and this is also a very important part of our talk, is that the technology for creating deepfakes will be ever more efficient, and it will create ever more realistic things. So at the moment, it is still pretty easy to detect a deepfake. So for example, if you just do something like that, then the deepfake will most likely break, because it does not think of, so we did not think about things like what happens if something covers the head. And it is also extremely difficult to just recreate a head in the back of the hand, which is covering your head at the moment. But these are technical limitations, and they can be overcome. So if we just go for a technical solution, there will always be someone who is trying to fool the technical solution. So the most obvious answer is there will never be a perfect technique for detecting deepfakes, and you should always be suspicious in who you think is in front of you.
Okay, and even more now after COVID, that we were all getting Zoom calls.
Yeah, we also tried it with some journalists who were unsuspecting at the beginning, and just went there as a deepfake, as a Jonas, for example, was the deepfake, and I just talked. He was just in the call but not talking. And after some time, we just said, "Hey, Jonas, is that really you?" And they just swapped the face, and they couldn't believe that they had fallen for a deepfake for so long.
Oh my God, that's actually very, very interesting. Any final thoughts that you want to share with the audience about your session or your project or anything?
I think it's really important to spread the word about that there is such a dangerous and at the same time fascinating technology out there, and that you should really be aware of who you are talking. It's like with Photoshop a few years ago. So back then, this was new, and everybody thought, oh, these models look so perfect. But in the end, everything's Photoshopped. And nowadays, you would not believe that anymore, that someone could look that perfect. And the same is true with deepfakes. So if people know that they should be suspicious and that they cannot automatically say that this is the person I'm talking to, then it's easier to, or it gets harder for criminals to use that.
Yes, we need more education, more people being conscious about the risks.
Yeah.
So I heard that your session was packed. Congratulations. I mean, it's a fascinating topic.
Thank you.
And I wish you the best for the rest of the conference. And thank you very much for being
Thanks.
Here.
Same for you.
Thank you.